Okay, we're back after break, and seems to me that the last thing we were talking about was being addicted to good things and getting high on spiritual experiences. Let me just make a disclaimer here, and then we'll move on. I don't think you can get too much of God. You can't get too close to Jesus. And, you know, whatever you mean by being high, I think that what people are, sometimes they say they're high on Jesus. Instead of being high on Jesus, they're really high on some sensation. See, and you don't associate Jesus with being a sensation. We don't talk about being addicted and getting high on some emotional experience. And I'm not taking anything away from emotional experiences. But that's what people get addicted to. And an addiction becomes destructive when it keeps you from doing the things you should do and being responsible for the things you ought to be responsible for. And so if you become addicted to some spiritual high that keeps you from fulfilling your purpose, and by the way, we do have a greater purpose than just being on a spiritual high. And, you know, sometimes we get addicted to feelings. We get addicted to emotions. Emotions are part of the human being. That's what makes us human. Emotions represents a very vital part of us. In fact, it's a very integral part of the soul. Soul being the will, the mind, and the emotions. But I don't think that God ever intended for us to be dominated by emotions or to be controlled by emotions. I don't believe that Jesus, I don't believe he repressed emotions. And by the same token, I don't believe that he necessarily, I know he did not allow emotions to have charge or have control. And so, yeah, we can become addicted to good things. Now, we are going to be dealing with behavioral or process addictions in one lesson. And we're going to be talking about such things as sexual addiction, food addiction, and some of those things. And there's some people, I believe, that are married and in the marital relationship are really acting out addictions. Mm-hmm. You see, just because you're married, I don't think that that doesn't mean that that sex ought to be the dominating theme of your life. It doesn't make a difference whether you're married or not married, you see. And so there are things that we can become so preoccupied with that it takes our attention away from the real important things, namely our purpose and our calling. Okay, the acute toxic effects of drugs. A toxic reaction is poisoning, plain and simple. A toxic reaction. Of course, we do also realize that there is a level of alcohol intoxication that is considered to be toxic to the point of being fatal, right? Mm-hmm. A toxic reaction is no different in kind from the milder intoxication caused by a drug. It's just when a person begins to take too much or too pure of a helping of a narcotic that you overdose, or you can mix a sedative with alcohol and the combined depressant effect can put you into a coma or halt breathing completely. Almost any drug will display toxic properties. What did we say toxicity was? Poison, plain and simple, right? Almost any drug will display toxic properties when consumed in sufficiently large quantities. We're running a little bit behind time here, but hey, we'll just do the best we can. We're going to look at some terms, long-term physical dangers and some psychological effects, developmental effects. Then we're going to be looking at the definition of drug dependency. And we're going to be in lesson number 2, which should have been at the beginning of this session. which is still a few pages off. We're going to be identifying alcoholics and drug addicted persons. Okay, let's take a look at some of the long-term physical dangers. Prolonged use of booze, which is Georgia talk for alcohol, degenerates the nerves in the arms and legs, destroys the brain cells, as well as can cause severe liver damage. Glue sniffing can have devastating effects on the kidneys and cell membranes in the brain. Cocaine can weaken the heart. Amphetamines can do permanent brain damage. Prolonged use of any of these drugs often lead to malnutrition, making one vulnerable to infection and disease. Malnutrition. What's the adage that some people drink their meals and they don't get the proper nutrition? Leads to malnutrition, breakdown of the body, resistance that leads to infection and disease. Even though that we have made an effort to minimize the effect of marijuana, long-term respiratory effects of prolonged marijuana use have been recognized. And there's always the danger to unborn children. Let's look at some of the psychological effects. Alcohol can cause organic psychosis and permanent disorganization of thought that result from physical damage to the brain.
You're right, Pastor.
Well, you're supposed to have a notebook there. Well, I can't stop to if you'd write down everything's already been written down. Alcohol can cause organic psychosis. That's all you need to write down, right? And permanent disorganization of thought that result from physical damage to the brain. I don't know about you guys, but I don't have any brain cells to waste. I need all I've got. I mean, I don't want any of them to die. Now, you may reproduce some other cells in your body, but you don't reproduce brain cells. Brain cells that die are dead. No more.
That's frustrating.
Brain cells cannot be reproduced.
I thought we'd be a genius. I never drank.
Well, there's no doubt in my mind, Jim, because you're nearly a genius now, so you must have.
Just imagine.
I mean, it's.
Brain cells can't be reduced. Can that be relative to blackouts?
Relative to blackouts? I'm assuming that I don't know how that ties in with dying brain cells. I'm just assuming that it just becomes such an overload that it overtaxes your sensory system until you just cease to function. You know, as far as the I would say, if you black out a few times, you know, it's going to.
Blackouts, like your brother had, you know. His high school name. I remember it's several nights in my life I never remember.
So your question is that tied in with dead brain cells?
Right. Because I got a bunch of them.
I would say that every time you blacked out, you probably killed a few brain cells.
Right. Okay.
And which would mean that, well, we look at people that have been involved in prolonged addictions. That their brain just seems to be, I mean, they just almost mentally incapacitated, aren't they?
Burnout.
Yeah.
I think blackouts have more to do with causing a chemical imbalance. You know, once you absorb so much alcohol,
it just ceases to function.
And, you know, you do kill a tremendous amount of brain cells, and the chemical imbalance that's caused from it just shuts your brain down. I think it literally shuts your brain down.
But in particular, my experience, the blackouts are really different than probably what happened to Raymond, or excuse me, your brother. your brother
that's the only brother I have. So
when I drank and got so drunk but the next day I didn't remember. But I had times in my life where I would seemingly function for several days, and to people around me, they thought that I was normal.
Oh, yeah.
But I don't remember anything.
Yeah, yeah.
That's to me, that's a blackout. When you are functioning.
Maybe that's a brownout.
When you're functioning, but you don't remember functioning.
Yeah.
I mean, and you don't even have to be that.
So, in other words, you don't have to be necessarily be in a stupor. You don't necessarily have to be unconscious.
I went started to New York City one time, and I came out of a blackout on a bus in Reno, Nevada, and don't remember any of the trip from New York to Reno, but I was functioning. You know, people, you know, talked about what we did for the 2 days prior to that, but I don't remember any of it.
Apparently,
and I wasn't that drunk. I was just blacked out. It wasn't caused from excessive intoxication. It was just caused from years of alcohol use. You know, I mean, it's my understanding that blackouts and passing out are different. It's not necessarily caused from.
Now, to set the record straight, I don't know whether my brother passed out or blacked out.
Right. Well, yeah, I'm just saying.
All I know is he didn't remember anything happened.
More likely passed out. He hadn't been dealing with.
I think so, because apparently it was something that he hadn't been accustomed to.
Blackouts come on down the road.
Yeah. After years of use.
Yeah. Okay.
Blackouts usually happen. Well, when they happen, you know what you're doing.
Right,
but you just don't remember it later.
Right. Other people tell you about it. You know,
how did I get home?
Yeah. You know, and you drove home. That's what's scary. You drive home and you get up the next day to check to see if you drove home.
So you can remember what happened that night, but in the morning you don't remember how you got there.
Right. You don't actually remember driving home.
Kenny, you must have been passed out when you found yourself out in the Gulf of Mexico.
I was in a blackout.
Blackout?
I just came to.
Oh, okay. All right, let's look at some of the psychological effects. Now, in just a moment, we're going to be taking a look at the difference in physical addiction and psychological addiction. Alcohol can cause organic psychosis and permanent.
What is organic?
Organic refers to the brain, organic psychosis. Organic psychosis and permanent disorganization of thought that result from physical damage to the brain. Literally, you can have psychological effects from physical damage.
Wet brain is a common term to people who have permanent brain damage after years of drinking. Call it wet brain.
Wet brain. Okay, that's a new terminology for me.
Okay. We've seen people like that. That's usually people who have been your stereotypical gutter drunks, winos on the street. Mm-hmm. That just have
kind of similar to what boxers go through from brain damage.
Yeah.
You know, they have mm-hmm. the same kind of demeanor almost. Mm-hmm. You know, very disorganized and mm-hmm. know what's going on.
Mm-hmm. What do they call it? Punch drunk?
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, boxers are the punch drunk. Yeah. Okay. Other drugs can cause chronic mental impairment as well as a wide variety of less permanently disorganizing effects. There are even what we call panic reactions that marijuana smokers sometimes experience. And there's always a consideration of paranoia. That especially grass, cocaine, and amphetamines occasionally trigger. Toxic psychosis appears much like paranoid schizophrenia and often lasts as long as a week and especially can afflict amphetamine users. Amphetamine. I found this to be very enlightening, very interesting in speaking about developmental effects. You ever hear the terminology that a person, say, that's been on drugs for a big part of their life as being a 38-year-old adolescent?
Yeah.
Or 36-year-old? And really, I've seen people that have been labeled at 40-year-old adolescents, that they really behave themselves as an adolescent. And the reason is because that in the developmental stages of the adolescent, when they should have been learning how to cope and dealing with their problems, you see, learning how to be involved in adult decision making, learning how to delay gratification, and all of those things that are important for normal adult functioning, is aborted or short-circuited. And so therefore, if you don't go through this process in a proper manner, you can end up 35, 40 years old and still fixated at that age of 15 or 16 in the way you deal with issues and the way you solve problems, the way you make decisions, and even in responsibility.
So it's true what they say, that when you start to use drugs, your mental growth stops.
Your mental?
Mental growth stops.
Your emotional too.
They say once you come sober, you have to mentally go back to the age that you began using.
Okay, so that's really what we're saying here, they become fixated. If you don't go through that process in a normal manner, you become fixated. You get stuck at that age.
Well, that makes you understand why people wonder how they can deal, especially with ones that are children of alcoholics, adult children of alcoholics, why they're having trouble dealing with their parents, because their parents are the children. You know, the parents are the adolescents and they're the adults. So he's just reversing things.
Well, of course, one of the problems that you run into adult children of alcoholics is that they have a hard time determining what's normal. They don't really have a standard by which they can determine what's normal behavior. Okay? And what people don't realize, and what adolescents don't realize, is that stress and pain are really essential ingredients of the development of life. See, what do we usually do? What do we do? What are we guilty of as Christians oftentimes? We want to avoid all pain. We want to avoid all stress. And, you know, especially like in the Word of Faith teaching, it was almost like there was never any consideration of anything that was stressful. And yet, those are necessary ingredients in order for you to learn how to deal with the issues of life. That's all part of the growing up process, the maturational process. And so when you avoid stress and pain through taking drugs, then what have you done? You have avoided an opportunity to learn how to deal effectively with that situation, not only at that point in time, but any that would arise in the future. You see, pain and stress are given for a reason. Our pain is, you know, pain is a very necessary ingredient and a part of our mechanism. You know what pain is designed for? You know why that God put the signal of pain in our bodies? To warn us when parts of our bodies or our lives aren't working as they should.
Oh, Lord.
You know what we do? We sedate that pain, do we not? What part do you want me to repeat? Okay, basically what I said was that I believe that pain is really a means of signaling that something is wrong. I mean, you know, pain in your, just like fever. Fever is a positive thing. Fever not only alarms us or brings to our attention that there's infection in our body, but the very process of the fever is fighting that infection, you see. Now, of course, you cannot allow fever to get out of hand, right? Because it can be destructive. But fever has a very positive impact on our physical bodies.
Well, they tell us, even as parents of young children, don't treat the temperature unless it's over like 100, 101 now, because you don't want to mask the fever completely. You want it to be able to fight and do what it's supposed to do. And if you, when it's 99, you start treating it, you're defeating the body's natural process.
That's
the
right.
Even tell us that now.
Okay. That's really validating what we're saying here. So what happens, say for example, if a person seeks to sedate their pain, to eliminate their pain through drugs and alcohol, what are you doing? You're ignoring the reason that pain was there. You're not dealing with the root of it, right?
Really, you're ignoring the early stages.
Early stages.
If you take care of it at the early stage, It doesn't have to develop into a major sickness, disease, but when we mask it early on, we have to keep masking it to cope.
There's something that doctors and medical personnel call empty pain.
Healthy.
Healthy pain.
Yeah.
Because
yeah.
when they know that they're having a pain at a certain place, they know that that part of the body is functioning.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. When we're having pain in our lives, I mean, we know there's something ain't right.
Mm-hmm.
And that's not to get it right.
So if you seek to cover it up, you're not really dealing right. with the issue. Right. You know, there are a lot of things that I think that as parents of younger children that we can become aware of. See, sometimes we very innocently may be conveying a message to our children that's telling them that drugs and medication is a way of dealing with pain.
Mm-hmm.
See, and, you know, I'm not telling you that if you've got unbearable pain that you're not going to do something about it. But, you know, running to the medicine cabinet every time you got a little pain, mm-hmm. you're sending a signal.
Right.
You're saying to your children the way to deal with this pain and this hurt is to medicate it.
Mm-hmm.
See? All right. Young drug users can escape the stress that is part of the maturation process.
What was the
strain and I don't know what number it is.
Feelings and perceptions.
Oh, okay. Psychoactive drugs alter feelings and perceptions. That's what you said a while ago. Alter. See, psychoactive drugs alter feelings and perceptions, which makes it possible for users to avoid dealing with unpleasant realities and to mask or dull pain and distress.
Mm-mm.
Then stress and pain are essential ingredients of normal life. Stress and pain are essential ingredients. And then young drug users can escape the stress that is part of the maturation process.
Part of the naturalization process?
Maturation.
Maturation.
That's the process of maturing. Maturation process. See, the truth is that every teenager, for example, goes through the stress and storm of the teenage years. And those times are important. You know why? Because you're learning, a teenager is learning lifelong attitudes. And they're learning to deal responsibly with ways, or dealing responsibly with ways of facing problems. It's during this period of time that young people learn to make long-range plans. They learn how to defer gratification, which means that you're willing to make sacrifices now for a greater reward later. An example would be, you're willing to forego getting a new car when you're 19 years old and first out of high school. You're willing to sacrifice that to drive an old beat-up car so that you can give yourself to get an education, you see, that will enable you to have a bigger payoff down the road. But most of the time, what are we involved in if we don't go through this normal process is that you don't learn how to delay gratification. You got to have it right now. Got to have it right now. You don't know how to wait for something that's better, you see. And that can apply in so many different areas, can it? I mean, you know, the same thing if you're talking about, you know, what's the guy's name, Tony? No, says, you know, why wait? Who's the guy that promotes it?
Josh
McDowell. Yeah, why wait? And what teenagers who haven't learned how to delay gratification, they say, you know, it's got to be right now. I've got to satisfy my lust and my addiction right now, you see. And so you abort the process of learning how to delay gratification. All right?
I think it's so important too, because we're out of our teenage years, at least biologically, physically, we're supposed to be, to look at teenagers and say, you know, that the emotional issues that they face, to us sometimes we laugh at and they seem so trivial. The broken boyfriend, girlfriend, you know, the friends that are fighting, but these are the early stages of them learning how to cope with relationships, and that they don't get it right there and don't get to cry and grieve and have all those emotions. How can we expect them to come into adulthood and be able to be in a marriage and have a commitment and know how to relate to people? I just think it's, you take a whole different light looking at teenagers when you hear something like this, that the process, what it's supposed to be.
In other words, it ought to be what we think is a painful process, and we may even try to help our teenagers to avoid that pain. Maybe very necessary. Maybe very necessary. Instead of saying, well, I'm going to go out and get drunk because I broke up with my girlfriend. See? Or I'm going to go out and get high. Okay. Young users may fail to ever develop adult coping mechanisms. Adult coping mechanisms. That's when you learn how to cope with your problems, is during adolescence. Interpersonal cost. If we don't learn how to deal with our problems in a proper manner, it can lead to undeveloped relationships. Undeveloped relationships. It's what we said a while ago, you know, when you address the issue of love, that maybe drugs initially will cause inhibitions to be brought down, you know, that would cause you to think in terms of becoming more intimately involved with someone. Drugs can and do enhance intimacy, but they rarely help relationships endure. They rarely help relationships to endure. Social drug use can limit the range of social contacts. Now, why would social drug use limit the range of social contacts?
Because there's a lot of areas of people that don't want you to use drugs.
So if you're involved in social drug using, what you're doing, you're limiting yourself in social contacts with people who likewise are involved in drugs. So you're limiting yourself, are you not? While solitary use may well lead to reduced contact and isolation. Solitary use not only may well, but it does. Solitary use does lead to reduced contact and isolation. Drug dependency or dependence. Drug abuse represents the compulsive use of a psychoactive substance that endangers physical or mental health. Drug abuse represents the compulsive use of a psychoactive substance that endangers physical or mental health. We're going to be looking at the different ways that drugs affect the central nervous system. We're going to categorize drugs as either basically what, stimulants or depressants. Different drugs stimulate different pleasure centers and produce different effects depending upon the particular center stimulated and the strength of the stimulation. Different effects. Different drugs are going to stimulate different pleasure centers and produce different effects depending upon the particular center stimulated and the strength of the stimulation. Now, if you're wondering why a person would initially get involved in heroin or amphetamines, and as we'll discover a bit later, that of course a true addictive drug is going to build up tolerance, which means that you have to keep increasing the use to get even the minimal effect. But you can understand perhaps why a person would initially get involved in drugs such as heroin or amphetamine, because it has been known that the rush of injected heroin or amphetamines mimics the intense pleasurable sensations of orgasm. Therefore, these drugs have high abuse potential. High abuse potential. Drug taking is self-reinforcing. Now, what does that mean, self-reinforcing? What do we mean by reinforcement? What do we mean by something being reinforced?
Cause that behavior to be duplicated.
All right, so reinforcement is the means by which that you reward a particular action, which would lead to repeating it, right? So drugs are self-reinforcing. And of course, it's like a vicious cycle, right? That you take the drug to get a certain effect, and then, of course, it just becomes a vicious cycle, just keeps reinforcing itself. The reinforcement becomes the drug experience itself. The power of reinforcement can lead to psychological dependence. The power of reinforcement can lead to psychological dependence. Okay, what do you think of, what do we mean by psychological dependence? We're going to study this a little bit more in detail, but what do you think we mean by psychological dependence?
You think that you have to have the drug.
All right, it's a craving that you think that you've got to have it. And that's in contrast to physical addiction, or what we call true addiction. True addiction is what? Physical addiction. And physical addiction means what? That you literally have withdrawal, physical withdrawal symptoms, right? Upon abstinence. And that there is a true tolerance that is developed, tissue tolerance. Okay? Physical dependency occurs when body cells are so changed by constant exposure to a drug that they become incapable of functioning properly when deprived of it. Physical dependency. There's literally a change. There's a change, bodily change, right? Experiential tolerance. We're going to get educated here in terminology. See, some of you folks, you know, you may have had the experiences, but you didn't have the terminology, or maybe you did. I don't know.
Yeah,
as I tell some of the students in my class, I say, well, if you don't get anything else out of this class, you get an increased vocabulary.
What was that tolerance you just said?
Experiential tolerance.
That's a true tolerance, huh?
No, not really. Experiential tolerance is when users of drugs to which true tolerance is developed also will boost the amounts they use even though their original dose remains just as effective. In other words, you develop a true tolerance, and then you will boost the amount that you take and not get any more effect than you would if you hadn't boosted the amount. You do so because you think, well, a little bit makes me feel this good, a whole lot more is going to make me feel better. Now, true tolerance would be what? Would be when you have to take increased amounts just to obtain the same effect. But experiential tolerance is when you think in terms of, well, if I take twice as much, I'll feel twice as good. In which you're not going to have any more effect than had you taken half as much.
And that would be psychological.
It'd be more psychological.
So experiential. Doesn't have anything to do with like experience.
Uh-uh. This is a desire for a higher high, a more profound and possibly longer lasting drug experience. This is something that I found to be probably one of the most interesting things that I have studied in the preparation of this class, and that is concerning how the body functions and how the body reacts in developing tolerance. The body is considered to be a very conservative organism. Now try to follow me in this explanation here in this line of thinking, because it really explains a lot to me. And I think it explains to us why that the body experiences withdrawal pains. And the reason why we say the body is a very conservative organism is because most of its efforts are devoted to maintaining the status quo and keeping things as they are. The body is designed to maintain the status quo, meaning that if you put something into your body that accelerates or say stimulates the body is going to counteract that, you see, that's going to seek to bring the body back into normal functioning. Or you can take on the other hand. If you put a depressant in your body, what the brain will do, or what the physical body will do, it will seek to establish the status quo. So if you put a depressant into your body, which slows the body down, the brain is sending out these signals, stay alert, stay alert, stay alert, you see. So it's increasing the chemicals that's going to bring you back up to the normal. And so when you quit putting those depressants in your body, then it's just like all of this stimulation is happening in your body, you see. Whereas the depressant would help to balance it out. You understand? You see where we're coming? Yeah.
I understand what you're saying, and it makes sense. But don't some drugs actually, the way they work is by releasing things that are in your body and in your brains to cause you to feel the way the drug makes you feel? I mean, wouldn't that sort of be contradictory to what you're saying? I mean, using the drug makes your body automatically want to react in the opposite way that the drug is making you react, is what you're saying. And like I said, that makes sense to me, but at the same time, isn't the way drugs operate by releasing things in your body that causes you to feel the way the drug makes you feel?
As I understand it, Jim, the drugs that that causes a certain effect is mimicking. You see, in other words, what you're saying is that, say, if the endorphins, you know, that make you feel good.
I mean, I always heard that cocaine, you know, one of the things it did was release.
Well, what it's doing is stimulating a certain part of your brain, see, which is causing your brain to act or to react. It's a placement in the placement of. In other words, if the drug is a stimulant, it's not necessarily releasing those chemicals in your brain that's causing that to happen. It's in the place of. You see, it's a substitute for. And so what the brain is doing, the body is doing, is seeking to counteract that. You see. And then, of course, when you cease to take that drug, see, the body that's trying to pull it back to normalcy is going to go further to the other way, you see. In other words, again, if you put a stimulant into your body, the body is going to release depressants to seek to keep the body in balance.
That's why you crash when you come off of it.
Yeah.
It's going to overreact, I guess. The body will.
Yeah, well, what happened? Yeah, because, say, again, if you put a depressant in your body and then the brain starts releasing the stimulants to counteract that, you take the depressants out and then you're overstimulated. See?
You can't sleep at all.
Right. And I think to answer your question is that it does not necessarily enhance these chemicals. It's in the place of, you see, and it seeks to override, but the body has a tendency, and that's the reason why we say the body is a conservative organ, because it seeks to bring the body back into normal functioning.
What about if a doctor medically puts somebody on like a depressant for that they're saying they have a true chemical imbalance and they've never engaged in having drugs all their life or whatever to damage the brain or something? I mean, did they say, here, you need this because your chemicals are not quite like they're supposed to be?
Okay, let's change the statement and we'll answer that, okay? Good. I mean, actually, this is what Kenny's speaking about here. You have these sensory receptors and it's like they have these synapses, which is a gap. In between, you have all these all the way through your body. And if a signal is sent through your body, then there has to be the neurotransmitters transmits the impulse from one of these receptors to the other. In other words, it's like a gap here. And you know, drugs, I don't know all the details of it, but you know, there's supposedly a medical explanation, a physiological explanation that shows how the drugs work as far as the connection here, that the overstimulation that can just keep playing over and over. Like, for example, certain drugs is just like a record just playing over and over and over and amplifies. See, it's just like it's just self-feeding. Now, that's supposedly the technical aspect of it, and I don't know all about it, but that's supposedly part of the physiological makeup of it. Okay, so as a user is dumping in sedatives, the body is attempting to jam the sedative signals with its own homemade stimulants. See, you're putting sedatives into your body, and so the body is reproducing excessive stimulants. Oh, what was your question again? Oh, okay. I'm sorry. Your question was, as I recall, was what about a doctor who prescribes, say, a medication to bring about a chemical balance in your body? And your question was, what if you've never done anything to bring an imbalance?
Yeah, a lot of people say that the chemical imbalances some people suffer is because of things they've done to their body. And my question was, what are you going to do with people that a medical doctor will tell you this is what's causing the chemical imbalance, and they're saying it's chemical?
Okay, first of all, I hear you questioning the doctor. Yeah.
Yeah, why they're doing it. Yeah.
Okay. All right, and let me see if I can explain that. All right, first of all, what I think that you're probably assuming is the only way you get a chemical imbalance is to have either the injection of some synthetic chemical such as drugs and alcohol.
I'm not sure.
I mean, that's what it sounds like to me. Okay, and so what you're saying is you haven't engaged in that, so why would you have a chemical imbalance?
Yeah.
See, the truth is that's not the only way you get chemical imbalance. Okay.
Well, that's what I don't understand. It's never been explained.
Well, I'm not a doctor.
Well, I know.
You know, I'm not a medical doctor. But I would say that, for example, if you're under so much stress, just a continuous stressful situation can change the chemicals in your body. Mm-hmm. Okay, there are a lot of things. Anxiety, fear.
So that can answer it, that most addicts have a chemical imbalance.
Yeah, and it may start out. You may start out with some legitimate, what you think is a legitimate reason to start taking drugs. It may be self-medication. It may be because you're trying to dull the pain, or it may be because you're trying to deal with anxiety, or you're trying to deal with pain. In fact, I guess cocaine, in a sense, is a kind of a type of self-medication, right? That helps you to supposedly deal with anxiety. See, and of course the introduction of drugs into your body is going to bring about certain chemical imbalances in your body, because you've got this constant struggle of the body seeking to produce either stimulants or depressants to counteract the other. And then when you quit putting the drug into your body, then you've got this imbalance. You see, you've got this struggle and this conflict. Well, if you've never been involved in drugs or alcohol, just the fact that you're under prolonged stress can cause chemical imbalance.
Is that a permanent situation now?
I would think that most doctors will say this. Now, you've got to understand there's some legitimate doctors and there's some quacks and there's some that aren't as diligent as others. Doctors are not God. They try to put themselves up as God sometimes, as, you know, being all-knowing. And the truth is that we do look at doctors, medical doctors, as being authorities, do we not? Because who are we, you know, to question their wisdom? We've never been to med school. So you go to the doctor, and you might as well trust him. You know, I mean, why would I go to the doctor to get help for something if I didn't trust him? And the only thing you can really do is seek a second opinion. And you're going to get differing opinions for the same condition. And so, you know, here you are, you're for whatever reason, got this chemical imbalance. I think that the thinking of medical doctors is that they don't put you on these drugs as a permanent solution. Supposedly, it's to get you to the place that things can even out, you see, or that you can reach a balance there, that the body will eventually readjust itself.
Now, isn't it true that the majority of the discoveries was not intended to be as they were? Now, here's an example. This drug, Deferim, Anabuse, it wasn't made to be retarded to alcohol, to alcoholics.
Mm-hmm.
But they find it to be.
Mm-hmm.
They're trying to make something else.
Mm-hmm.
So they don't know what else it does, you know? So, I mean, wouldn't that be dangerous to take if you don't know what you're taking?
Yeah, I would
what
say.
What else it may cause, you know, if they don't know, they know that it takes care of alcohol. If you drink on it, it makes you ill, but they don't know what else it does.
Well, and that's the reason why that drugs come on the market and go off the market. Isn't it? I mean, and really what it becomes a matter of trial and error, it becomes a matter of us being human guinea pigs. I mean, what may be designed as a positive thing can end up being a very detrimental thing and is pulled off the market. So, you know, we don't always know. And I've always said this, that it doesn't make a difference what kind of medication you're on. It always has a side effect, doesn't it?
Right,
sure.
And so you have to have a trade-off. It's really a trade-off. You have to decide which is the lesser of two evils, really.
Changing seats on Titanic.
Changing seats on Titanic.
TV, the prescription drugs now, they'll start listing off side effects.
You know? Yeah, I'm thinking, you know, they have a responsibility to warn you of all the side effects.
Yes. Mm-hmm.
And I'm looking at all these side effects, I'm saying, who in their right mind is going to take the chance of taking this drug? But, you know, we...
Taking something so your eyes don't water and it tells you it causes headaches, vomiting,
abdominal pain.
You know, my eyes water.
But
you know,
so it's a trade-off.
It's crazy. The side effects are worse than what you're taking it for to begin with.
But I have found on the question that I asked you about what medical doctors do, mm-hmm. They put me on depressants because they said I had a chemical imbalance. They couldn't figure out why.
Put you on what?
Antidepressants. Uh-huh. Because they said I had a chemical imbalance, and they couldn't figure out why, which I have found out going through things in my past and dealing with things. A lot of it was stress.
Stress.
And now that I have come out from under, I'd say 75% of the stress, I'm still dealing with some, I have found that I don't need the depressant.
That's right.
So I came off of the depressant, and I have been able to function better now than I'm off of than I was even when they had me on.
But don't you think a lot of people stay on medication for fear that
they won't come off? Mm-hmm. A lot of us fear the unknown. Well, if I don't take this and then I get healed, then what?
Uh-huh.
And so a lot of it's a fear of because they don't know what's going to be after even the healing. Even though it's a good thing to get healed, they're still afraid of what's going to be on the other side of it. Uh-huh. And I got caught on that track for a while. I was afraid to step over or come off of because I didn't know what was over there. Of course, I know now it's a good thing.
Yeah.
So.
So the whole thing is that we're still going to have to deal with the problem, you know, and
one way or the other.
You're going to have to get down to dealing with what the root issue is. All right, as a result of the body seeking, of course, to jam the sedative signals with its own homemade stimulants, as a result, it takes greater amounts of barbiturates to achieve the same degree of sedation. Now this explains tolerance, okay? Now what do we say tolerance was? Tolerance means that you have to keep increasing the usage just to get the same normal effect. Why is that so? Because the sedatives you put in your body is making the homemade stimulants, see, to counteract it, and it means you have to put more barbiturates, more depressants into your body to counteract that. And so to get the same effect, you've got to keep increasing because the body is seeking to react against it. And that's what tolerance is. That's what we mean.
Yeah. I think
we've
talked us through that, but we missed the fill in the blanks.
What did we miss?
I was paying attention listening, and I missed the fill in the blanks.
Tell me where we're supposed to be, and I'll...
Seven A.
Now, I don't know what 7A is. Read what you got.
The central nervous system is continually being stimulated by a drug. The body will attempt to blank this foreign influence.
Okay, counteract this foreign influence. When the central nervous system... I probably need to have my own little notebook here, don't I? Okay. When the central nervous system is continually being stimulated by a drug, the body will attempt to counteract this foreign influence. If it's a sedative being put in your body, the body is going to seek to counteract that by creating more stimulants. If you put a stimulant in your body, the body is going to seek to counteract the stimulant by creating more sedatives or more depressants. Okay? While the drug is telling the appropriate parts of the brain to slow down, the body's own chemical messengers are carrying a stay alert message to the affected nerve tracts.
Back up. While a user of depressants is loading a morphine dose, the brain will struggle
to function normally. Well, y'all bear with me. I mean, it's just the first night.
Function normally.
Function normally.
Okay.
Okay, y'all stay with me. I mean, keep me alert.
As the users, don't
see what you're doing. You're counteracting, bringing a balance here. All right, and then while the drug is telling the appropriate parts of the brain to slow down, the body's own chemical messengers are carrying a stay alert message to the affected nerve tracts. As the user is dumping in sedatives, the body is attempting to jam the sedative signals with its own homemade stimulants. As a result, it takes greater amounts of barbiturates to achieve the same degree of sedation. Greater amounts. That's what we call tolerance. Greater amounts of barbiturates. When the barbiturate user suddenly quits cold, see, you quit putting barbiturates into your body, the body's stay alert messages continue to flow. This is called rebound. Y'all not folding up yet? We're not through. We're not through. All right. So what happens is you quit putting these barbiturates in your body, and the brain keeps sending these stay alert signals. The brain is stimulated to hypersensitivity. With no external sedatives to reduce the stimulation, so you cut down on your sedatives that would balance out this overstimulation, the user experiences an abstinence syndrome. An abstinence syndrome. Which is another word for withdrawal. Abstinence syndrome.
Man, you look terrible this morning. Oh man, I'm just having some abstinence syndrome.
The user needs to sustain drug use to avoid the discomfort created by rebound or withdrawal symptoms. See, you quit putting the drugs into your body. For example, the depressants. You quit putting the depressants, and the stimulants are still being produced by your brain that's overstimulating you. And therefore, you've got to pick up using the depressants again to counteract this. And really what you're doing is you keep taking the drugs to ease the pain of withdrawal, right?
This may be something you're going to talk about later, but talking again about tolerance. Another thing, and I don't think it's this case with all drugs, but some drugs, if you take them, abuse them, and you increase your tolerance, it comes to a point where the tolerance level and the overdose level intersects. And you may get to a point where, in order to achieve the effect that you want,
you can overdose.
You have to increase more, and you will actually overdose before you get to the point where you take it enough to get the effect that you want.
Okay, and another issue, here's another problem. Is that, say for example, after you have gone through withdrawals, then that means that if you've gone through drying out or withdrawals, then your body gets back down to the level that it takes less to get an effect. You see, and if you haven't adjusted your intake, say for example, you're used to taking a large amount, and then your tolerance has dropped, then you can overdose. Another thing is that if you start getting cut down drugs, you don't ever know what you're getting in drugs. You start getting drugs that are less powerful, Or if you get adjusted, if your body gets adjusted taking these less powerful drugs, and then you get drugs that are more powerful, you can overdose. So many variables, aren't they?
Yes.
So many variables. Russian roulette. All right. At the furthest reach of addictions, drugs become central to the user's life. There is a preoccupation with getting and taking drugs. There's no capacity to limit use. And there is a continued use in spite of obviously adverse effects. You may know that you're damaging your body, but you still put them into your body. And then addicts will steal to pay for drugs, will persist in drug use even when it endangers them or is destroying other aspects of their life. They will resume use after withdrawal and periods of abstinence. They will resume use even after withdrawal and periods of abstinence. Y'all know what? We're not going to get through, we may not even get into lesson two, so we may stay behind here. We're still in lesson one. We do need to get a foundation. We need to get a good solid foundation. All right, now here's a question of vulnerability, and here's a question of personality factors. Is there a gene called an alcoholic gene? The answer is no. There is not a cocaine gene. There is not a gene that is passed down from one generation to the other that's called an alcoholic gene. But there are certain predispositions. There are certain personality factors that can be passed down that can make one more vulnerable to addiction, you see. Now, we want to identify some of those factors. Okay, where there appears to be no single unique personality entity, where there appears to be no single unique personality entity, in other words, there does not seem to be borne out by research that there is a single personality gene. There are significant personality factors which contribute to addictions of all kinds. Personality factors. And we're going to name some of those personality factors. We're going to address some of those factors. One is that a person who is given to impulsive behavior, of course, what does impulsive behavior refer to?
Acts quickly without thinking.
I mean, just moving on an impulse, behaving on an impulse without even thinking. Just, you get a feeling and you act on that feeling, right? Mm-hmm. So a person who's given to impulsive behavior is going to be more prone to addictions. And that's pretty self-explanatory, isn't it? All right. Another factor is the difficulty in delaying gratification. Difficulty in delaying gratification. Now, I explained that earlier. Delaying gratification means that you're willing to make certain sacrifices for the moment for a bigger payoff down the road. Delayed gratification. If you don't delay gratification, you say, I've got to have it right now. For a person who's got to have it right now, they're more prone to addiction. So wouldn't you think that in parenting that you ought to be teaching your children how to, first of all, how to stop and think, you know, before you act? You need to teach them how to make personal sacrifices for the moment. Now, what do parents do to counteract that teaching? They give them what they want. They demand it, and they give it to them. How are they going to learn delayed gratification if you give it to them right when they want it?
Or they tell them one thing, and then they exhibit other behaviors. You know, they don't exhibit that delayed gratification in their own life.
So what are you doing? I mean, when you give a child everything they want right when they want it, you're setting them up, and you're making them vulnerable for addiction. That's another addictive factor. Absolutely, and of course addicts are master manipulators. Okay, another personality factor is sensation seeking. I mean, you live on the wild side and you always got to have something sensational. Always got to be some new excitement. Don't we have kids like that? I mean, don't we have a generation like that? You know, they're so bored. Get so many toys on Christmas morning. What in the world are you going to do for an encore? You know, I mean, the kids get bored and they're going to go out and they're going to seek to do something that's on the risky side. Or another factor is antisocial personality. A person who has an antisocial personality is going to be more prone for addictions. Antisocial.
You know, you're just talking about that sensation seeking, about getting all the toys at Christmas and everything. They actually, or this was said that they done a study with two kids. They brought them in for an evaluation, not evaluation, they brought them in for observation. Sam, you know this, don't you?
Well, then
the observation of the two kids. They put one in a, it was an observation of children. Mm-hmm. They put one little boy in this room full of toys. I mean, just tons and tons of toys. And they put this other little boy in a room full of horse manure and a shovel. And a couple hours later, they come back, and the little boy, they observed the little boy in the room full of toys to just be sitting there twiddling his thumbs. They asked him, said, well, what's wrong? He said, well, there's just so many good toys here. He said, I've done played with them all. He said, but there's still something missing. And they went to the other room to observe the little boy that they put in the room full of horse manure and a shovel. And then, boy, he was just in there just digging away. I mean, he was digging that horse manure, shoveling it around with a smile on his face. And they asked the little boy what was wrong, you know, what was he so happy about? He said, surely in a room with this much horse manure, there's got to be a pony in here somewhere.
We needed that, didn't we? You know, I think that. Honestly, we're bringing out some points here that would really be some good parenting points. Now, I think there's several lessons that we can learn from this. Now, what do we usually as parents, and when I say we as parents, I'm talking about some of us older parents who have kids who have been through some of this stuff, you know. And we can take one of two views. One is that we can refuse to take any responsibility, and the other is that you take full responsibility when you should. And it's hard to find a balance there. The truth is, I think that we have to take some responsibility, and yet we can't take full responsibility. And I say we have to take some responsibility because unknowingly, oftentimes, we have been guilty of parenting practices which may, unknowing to us, has been fostering certain personality traits that would make a person more open for addiction. For example, if you give in to a child and give everything to them that they want, they learn to never be satisfied, never to be thankful, you see, what are you doing? You're setting them up to be bored with life. And then what are you going to do? You're going to do something more outrageous to satisfy that exploration or whatever. Okay, another personality factor, is nonconformist values. Nonconformist values. Nonconformist values. In other words, if you take a person who's always anti, they just refuse to be a conformist. They're going to be more liable to addictions. Another factor is little regard for goals, generally valued by society. Little regard for goals, generally valued by society.
Which sort of falls in with a nonconformist, really.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, it would be, wouldn't it? All right, a sense of alienation, G, is a sense of alienation and great tolerance for deviant behavior.
That's both G?
That's G, yeah. A sense of alienation, feeling alienated, and having a great tolerance for deviant behavior. Now, I think that we need to respect people that are different. But when you have a sense of alienation and a great tolerance for deviant behavior, you're going to be setting yourself up for more susceptibility and more vulnerability to addiction abuse. Another personality factor is heightened feelings of stress. Heightened feelings of stress. People that are always under elevated stress are going to be more vulnerable. Another factor is limited capacity for affection. Limited capacity for affection. And I think that kids that have a limited capacity for affection are probably brought up in a family that's not very touching, or they don't show a lot of feelings, a lot of emotions. If you don't have proper love demonstrated, you're not going to have to learn, you're not going to really know how to respond. J is small tolerance for frustration. Small tolerance for frustration. Your frustration level, your tolerance for frustration is very low. Your threshold is very low. It doesn't take much to tick you off, right? And of course, another climate, and this is what we call sometimes creating a climate or the soil for addiction. And one fertile soil for addiction is when there's a lot of family distress and family problems. SK. I don't have L, I don't think, do I?
No.
But I do have L. Let me give it to you. Feelings of hostility, usually toward the father. Feelings of hostility toward the fathers that can translate into negative attitudes about authority. Feelings of hostility toward their father that translates into negative attitudes about authority. If you have hostile feelings toward your father in particular, because you think of your father as being an authority figure, right? Have hostile feelings toward an authority figure, then that translates into negative attitudes in general about authority. All right, I'll give you a couple of other quick injections here, and then we'll go. It's already 9:05, but we've got a real late start, and we don't have everything we need to, but just give me about 2 minutes. Other aspects of compulsive use involves those who are extremely sensitive to the effects of drugs. In other words, if you have a person, some people have a different level of tolerance. Some people are more sensitive than others. So if you have a person that has an extreme sensitivity to drug effects, then they're going to be more vulnerable. So extreme sensitivity to drug effects, self-medicating, taking drugs to relieve the symptoms of real physical or psychological disorders. Self-medicating, taking drugs to relieve the symptoms of real physical or psychological disorders. Okay, that's going to cover everything that we need to for tonight, or let's say that's all we're going to cover for tonight. And we'll pick up on lesson 2 the next time, and if we don't get caught up, we'll be one lesson behind. And so I've enjoyed it. It's been good, and be looking forward to you coming back next Tuesday.